Hello students, we are back here to study statistics. In the previous session, we were studying exercise 14.4. In that, we were calculating mean, median and mode. We had studied those concepts and we were calculating that. But as all of us we know very well that CBSE has revised our syllabus. Hence, this topic is deleted from the syllabus for the current year. So, we had solved 4 questions in the previous session. We shall conclude the chapter here itself. And we shall proceed further to the next chapter, that is probability. We shall start studying probability, which you had studied in your previous class. Let us see what next in that we are going to study. Here the introduction in probability, it explains us, in everyday life we come across statements such as it will probably rain today, it will probably rain today, I doubt that he will pass the test, most probably Kavita will stand first in the annual examination, chances are high that prices of diesel will go up. There is a 50-50 chance of India winning a toss in today's match. I hope this has recalled you your previous studies of probability. These are the different statements that are made here. The words probably, doubt, most probably, chances, etc. used in the statements above involve an element of uncertainty. Involve an element of uncertainty. For example, in one, probably rain will mean it may rain or may not rain today. Yes. What is the meaning of that? It means what? It may rain or may not rain today. We are predicting rain today based on our past experience when it rained under similar conditions. What? On what basis we are predicting? On our past experience. When it rained under similar conditions. Similar predictions are also made in other cases listed in 2 to 5. Simple thinking that when it was raining on some previous day, before that the clouds had become very dark, it had become very dark and cool breeze was blowing, the air was very cool. The atmospheric conditions were just likely to rain and it started raining. When this happened in the previous day, some day when it was raining. On that experience, today we are predicting rain again. But every time it may rain or may not rain, we cannot be firm on that. But we are predicting it. It is a possibility, it is a chance. The same predictions or similar type of predictions are also made in other cases listed in 2 to 5. The uncertainty of probably, etc. can be measured numerically by means of probability in many cases. What happens? The uncertainty of probably etc. can be measured numerically by means of probability in many cases. Means we can measure it numerically. Though probability started with gambling, it has been used extensively in the fields of physical sciences, commerce, biological sciences, medical sciences, weather forecasting, etc. What they are saying, though probability started with gambling, it has been used extensively in fields, in all these fields they are saying it has been extensively used. Proceeding further, here in the box you can see the information about two mathematicians connected with probability. You can read it and get the knowledge. In earlier classes, you have had a glimpse of probability when you performed experiments like tossing of coins, throwing of dice, etc. Yeah, in the previous class you have studied it. So, and observed their outcomes. You will now learn to measure the chance of occurrence of a particular outcome in an experiment. Now what you will learn? You will now learn to measure, what to measure? The chance of occurrence of a particular outcome in an experiment. Okay, what they are saying? Take any coin, it is activity, it has been told to us. Take any coin, toss it 10 times and note down the number of times a head and a tail come up. Record your observations in the form of the following table. You can do this activity in your house. It is a very simple thing and it is very much understanding thing for probability. What they are saying, take a coin, toss it 10 times and note down the number of times a head and a tail come up. Record your observations in the form given below. Here you can record it in this way. And further, what they are telling, write down the values of the following fractions. Number of times a head comes up upon total number of times the coin is tossed. Total number of coins, number of times the coin is tossed is 10. Okay, and number of times a head comes up, that you have to note down, and after 10 times tossing the coin, you can write this value here. First you are recording here the total number of times the head has come up and number of times the tail has come up. Similarly, number of times a tail comes up upon total number of times the coin is tossed. So what is the third, that is the first activity, that is the first thing that they have told us. See what the things they are telling further. Toss the coin 20 times in the same way. Record your observations as above. Again, find the values of the fractions given above for this collection of observations. Means firstly they are telling to toss 10 times the coin. Now again, while repeating the activity for the second time, they are telling us to toss the coin 20 times in the same way and record your observations. Okay, and again find the values of the fractions given above for this collection of observations. Okay, third thing, repeat the same experiment by increasing the number of tosses and record the number of heads and tails. Once they told to do the experiment for 10 times tossing, second they told 20 times. Now they are saying repeat it for the third time. What they are saying, repeat the same experiment by increasing the number of tosses. means make it 25 times or 30 times or 40 times it is left. Then find the values of the corresponding fractions. Yes, they are saying find the values of the corresponding fractions. You will find that as the number of tosses get larger, the values of the fractions come closer to 0.5. You will find that as the number of tosses gets larger, what happens further? The values of the fractions come closer to 0.5. To record what happens in more and more tosses, the following group activity can also be performed. One more activity they are explaining here. Divide the class. Now this is a class activity actually. Let us only understand it. That individual activity you can do in your house. So currently it is possible for you. Second activity what they are explaining, let us understand. Divide the class into groups of 2 or 3 students. Let a student in each group toss a coin 15 times. Another student in each group should record the observations regarding heads and tails. Note that coins of same denomination should be used in all the groups. It will be treated as if only one coin has been tossed by all the groups. Suppose you have taken a coin of 1 rupee, all the groups should take the coin of 1 rupee. So that what will happen? We can say that 1 rupee coin was tossed. Suppose there happened that there are 20 groups in your class, means of 2-2 we have thought, 40 is the class strength. So if we consider 2-2 students group, there are 20 groups and all of them they are tossing 1 rupee coin. So we can say 1 rupee coin was tossed 20 times, because in 20 groups at a time they are tossing the same coin, that is 1 rupee coin. Now on the blackboard make a table like 15.2. Group 1 can write down its observations and calculate the resulting fractions. Then group 2 can write down its observations, but we'll calculate the fractions for the combined data of groups 1 and 2 and so on. That is what we may call these fractions as cumulative fractions. This we have studied in the previous chapter. Cumulative means what? You know very well. So we may call these fractions as cumulative fractions. We have noted the first 3 rows based on the observations given by one class of students. Here they have done it. Group 1, number of heads 3, number of tails 12. Cumulative number of heads upon total number of times the coin is tossed. Total how many times the coin is tossed? 15 times. 3 times head has turned up and 12 times tail has turned up. So total it is 15. And cumulative number of heads. For heads here it is 3. 3 upon 15. And cumulative number of tails upon total number of tails, total number of times the coin is tossed, not total number of tails, it is total number of times the coin is tossed. So cumulative number of tails 12, and what about the total number of times the coin is tossed? 15. Means here the fractions are 3 upon 15 for cumulative number of heads, and for cumulative number of tails it has become, what is that become, fraction has become 12 upon 15. Second group, they got number of heads 7 and number of tails 8. Here they have said cumulative number of heads, means what? previous group number of heads plus this group which has got number of heads, that is 7 plus 3 upon total number of times the coin is tossed. Yeah, it is 12 plus 3 is 15. 15 times group 1 has tossed the coins and group 2 also has tossed the coins 15 times. So 7 plus 3 upon 15 plus 15. 7 plus 3 is 10 and 15 plus 15 is 30. So the fraction is 10 upon 30. Let us come to the next column, that is for cumulative number of tails. 8 plus 12 upon 15 plus 15, that is 20 upon 30. Let us come to the third row, which is representing group 3, number of heads 7 and number of tails 8. Cumulative number of heads, previously 10, now 7 plus 10, 17. And what about total number of times the coin is tossed? Again plus 15. Previously it has become 30, now plus 15 it becomes 45. Right? 15 of this group, 15 of this group, 15 of this group. So 15, 15, 15, it becomes 45. Come to the last column, cumulative number of tails. Previously it has become 20, now it is becoming 8 plus 20, that is 28. And again the total number, just now I had explained, it is 15 plus 30, it is 45. So the fraction is 28 upon 45. What do you observe in the table? You will find that as the number of tosses of the coins increases, the values of the fractions in columns 4 and 5 come nearer and nearer to 0.5. They are telling about these fractions as the number of coins, okay, as the number of tosses, not number of coins, sorry, number of tosses of the coin increases, these fractions will what happen? You will find that they are coming nearer to, they have said, they come nearer to what? 0.5. Oh, nearer and nearer to 0.5. Now, activity 3. Activity, what is the third activity? They are saying that throw a die. There is a small star you can see here. Let us see what is the meaning of the star later on. Throw a die 20 times and note down the number of times the numbers, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 come up. Record your observations in the form of table, as in table 15.3, means the table that is given below. Now what is the meaning of this, what is the meaning of this star, what they are, it is indicating? After a die, a star has been given here, which means that a die is a well balanced cube with its six faces marked with numbers from 1 to 6. One number on one face, sometimes dot appears in place of numbers. Yeah, what is the meaning of die? They are telling that. What they are telling, a die is a, what a die means? A die is a well balanced cube with its six faces marked with numbers from 1 to 6. One number on one face, sometimes dot appear in place of numbers. Okay. Proceeding further, you can see the table to record your observations in the form of a table. Here it is given, number of times a die is thrown, it is mentioned 20. Number of times these scores turn up, that these are the possible outcomes. So how many times these are turning up, you have to record. This also activity you can do. Further, find the values of the following fractions. Number of times one turned up upon total number of times the dice thrown. Number of times two turned up upon total number of times the dice thrown. Number of times six turned up upon total number of times the dice thrown. After that, in the activity, the second thing they are asking to do, now throw the die 40 times as they had asked us for tossing a coin. Similarly for the die, they are telling the same thing. Now throw the die 40 times, record the observations and calculate the fractions as done in first one. In the above table, in the same way we are going to record. As the number of throws of the die increases, what they are saying, number of throws of the die increases, you will find that the value of each fraction calculated in 1 and 2 comes closer to 1 upon 6. To see this, you could perform a group activity as done in activity 2. Yes. Again, group activity can be performed of this. Divide the students in your class into small groups. Let us understand what exactly the activity is. It is in the same way. Into small groups, one student in each group should throw a die 10 times. Observations should be noted and cumulative fractions should be calculated. The values of the fractions for the number 1 can be recorded in table 15.4. This table can be extended to write down fractions for the other numbers also, or other tables of the same kind can be created for the other numbers. So 15.4 table is given. Same way, groups are being written here, and total number of times a die is thrown in a group, and cumulative number of times one turned up upon total number of times the die is thrown. So in this way, the recording can be done. We can record it. The dice used in all the groups should be almost the same in size and appearance, then all the throws will be treated as throws of the same die. What do you observe in these tables? You will find that as the total number of throws gets larger, the fractions in column 3 move closer and closer to 1 upon 6. Yes. What they are telling, as the throws get larger, the fractions in the columns 3, means where we are going to calculate the fraction, what happens? It move closer and closer to 1 upon 6. Activity 4. Toss 2 coins simultaneously 10 times. Now, in activity 1, one coin was tossed. Now in activity 4, two coins are tossed simultaneously. How many times? 10 times. And record your observations in the form of a table as given below. Same thing. Here the first table, number of times two coins are tossed, it is 10. Number of times no head comes up, means both are tail. Number of times what? Number of times one head comes up, and number of times two heads come up. See the different events, the different possibilities. Number of times no head comes up, number of times one head comes up, and number of times two heads come up. This activity you can do very easily in your house. Write down the fractions. A is what? A is equals to number of times no head comes up upon total number of times two coins are tossed. Similarly, B is the even. B, what is B? Number of times one head comes up upon total number of times two coins are tossed. C is equals to number of times two heads come up upon total number of times two coins are tossed. Calculate the values of these fractions and now increase the number of tosses as you had done in activity 2. You will find that more the number of tosses, the closer are the values of A, B and C. 0.25, 0.5 and 0.25 respectively. In activity 1, each toss of a coin is called a trial. Similarly, in activity 3, each throw of a die is a trial, and each simultaneous toss of two coins in activity 4 is also a trial. What they are explaining us? In activity 1, each toss of a coin is called a trial. What is a trial? Each toss of a coin, not the outcome. Don't think of what we are, if we are getting head or if we are getting tail. No, when we are tossing the coin, it is known as what? Once we have tossed, it is the trial that we have taken. It is called a trial. Similarly, in activity 3, each throw of a die, it is a trial, and each simultaneous toss of two coins of, what they are saying, each simultaneous toss of two coins in activity 4 is also a trial. So a trial is an action which results in one or several outcomes. What is a trial? The experiment that we are knowing, it is termed as trial. So a trial is an action, means tossing a coin is an action, throwing a die is an action, all these are trials. So a trial is an action which results in one or several outcomes. Now, one outcome means what? When you toss a coin, what is the outcome? Head or tail? When you throw a die, what happens? 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 6. It is one outcome. And what about several outcomes? When you are tossing simultaneously two coins, what are the several outcomes? It can be both of the coins may turn up head, both of the coins may turn up tail, or either of them may turn up head and tail. Head or tail, not end or. So the possible outcomes in the activities were head and tail, whereas in activity 3 the possible outcomes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. In activity 1, the getting of a head in a particular throw is an event with the outcome head. Similarly, getting a tail is an event with the outcome tail. What they have said? So the getting of a head in a particular throw is what? It is an event with outcome head. Similarly, getting a tail is an event with outcome tail. In activity 2, the getting of a particular number, say 1, is an event with outcome 1. So I hope you understand what they are trying to explain us. This session we shall conclude here. In the next session we shall proceed further. Till that time, you people take care of yourselves and study properly and regularly. Thank you.